Welcome to Journey Through the Unknown. My memoirs, as read by me, myself, and I, Murray Langston. For your information, I will be reading this while not wearing any underwear. So you don't have to wear underwear while reading it either. Thank you. My memoirs actually details each year of my life. So let's begin with June 27th, 1944. The headline of the New York Times on June 27th, 1944 read, "Cherbourg falls to American troops. Russians capture Vitebsk and Zlobin." The end of the Second World War was nearing. The other surprising news on that same day, well, at least to me, was that I was born in Dartmouth, Nova Scotia, a small town in Canada. I was actually so surprised that I couldn't speak for a year and a half. Because my parents were extremely poor, to celebrate my birth, the best my dad could do was hand out cigarette butts. When my father first saw me, he gave me a funny look, and I guess I've had it ever since. My parents named me Murray, which I'm grateful for because to this day, that's what everyone calls me. Years later, I remember wanting to know the exact time of my birth so a friend could more thoroughly research my horoscope. I called my mom, and the best she could offer was that I was born sometime between midnight and 2 a.m. She further informed me that I wasn't born in a hospital, but in a manger. I mean, a small bungalow where my parents lived at the time. My father's birthday was the day before mine, and a party celebrating it was being held. So I was born amidst an abundant amount of drinking going on. According to my mom, the doctor who showed up to deliver me was a bit of a drinker himself, and he immediately joined in the festivities. He became inebriated to the point where he forgot to write down on the paperwork the exact time of my birth, so it was never recorded. I've often wondered whether being born in the midst of a party could be the reason for the positive, fun attitude that has defined me throughout most of my life. I was my parents' second child. My older brother, Ronald, was born less than a year before on July 3rd, which meant that for 6 days every year, we were the same age. Not that that means anything. What does mean something is that during that first year, I was not breastfed because my mom had been convinced that formula was better for babies than breast milk. When years later she informed me of this, it would forever account for my lack of trust in the world of big business. Like the foundation of a building, a child's foundation is also very important for its longevity, and powdered formula would be akin to using wood instead of concrete for support. I do, however, miss that first year of having my diapers changed, my private areas slathered with warm soap and water, and my butt washed and powdered. But I'm told if I hang in there long enough, nurses will be doing all that again for me. Yoo-hoo! Other than that, I don't remember much of that first year, 1944, except that it was very hard to find work. Looking back, although we were very poor and had little material wealth, I was loved by my mom and dad, and for that I was a pretty lucky baby. 1945. This was the year I attempted walking, and I would get confused when the adults around me laughed whenever I fell on my face. I also found it frustrating trying to understand what everyone around me was talking about, especially my mom and dad. I did later learn that Dad met Mom when he was 20 and she was 19. He barely spoke a word of French, and Mom, a pretty French-Canadian girl, barely spoke a word of English. Nevertheless, they fell in love. They couldn't talk much, but obviously understood body language, so without much discussion, they had 5 kids in rapid succession. Mom eventually learned English, though she always had a slight accent, but Dad never learned French except for the kissing part. I'm pretty sure Mom's first English phrase must have been something like, "Get off me!" I also learned Dad had a troubled and violent relationship with his father and left home at the age of 12 or 13. Mom was raised mostly in an orphanage because her parents couldn't afford to raise all of their 14 children. Another interesting tidbit is that I have no recollection of having ever met any of my grandparents, neither on Mom's nor on Dad's side of the family. Apparently, they all passed on in their 50s, but somehow a couple of my great-grandparents lived to be over 100. I've often wondered in which group's longevity footsteps I would follow, especially with my lousy foundation. Toward the end of 1945, in fact, on New Year's Eve, probably during another drunken soiree at our tiny home, my sister Annette was...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.